Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Canal Town Community Church for our Sunday worship service. We have a small group today, but at any group is always good. So the sun is shining. We're not getting wet. That's kind of nice. I was able to drive by my motorcycle in today, which was kind of a treat for me. And so welcome. I'd like to open us up with a call to worship from Psalm 118, and I'm beginning in verse 24. It says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. O Lord, save us. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With bows in our hand, we join the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." I am so thankful for a God whose love endures forever, because I know that there's a lot of times that I'm unlovable. But God loves me. He loves you. Even with our warts and our bruises and the failings that we have. And that's a reason to praise him. So if you're able, let's stand together as we sing praises to God.
Together worthy. together wonderful to me.
Father's love.
for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers.
Good morning. Let's go before his throne. Let's go boldly before his throne this morning. Heavenly Father, I thank you for each one's here today, Lord, to hear your word and to meditate upon your word, Lord. We have so much to come before your throne and to require of your, you already know everything that we have need of, Father, we know, but what a privilege to come before your throne in time of need, Lord. Thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, Father. Thank you for this new day. I just pray that you be with Pastor Chris this morning. Give him the words to speak that would penetrate our hearts, Lord, and that we would remember. Father, we have a number of requests this morning to come before you and to ask of you. We think of Jacob. Little boy that doesn't seem to have much longer. You know his number of days, Lord. We pray for a sense of your presence, Lord, for Jacob. We think of Lloyd, Lord. We pray for continued peace, Lord. I pray for comfort for Lloyd. I thank you for the Clark family and all they do to give him that peace and that comfort, Lord. We think of Craig for healing, Lord. We think also of Mitchell, Father, for his new faith in you, Lord. I just pray for strength there. And Father, for his new opportunity in Rochester for more study, more surgery, Lord. I just pray you be with him during this time. I praise you for all you've done already with his tumors, Lord. And Father, we think of our nation and our leaders, our president. We just pray for each one of them. Father, I lift up all the churches that preach the true gospel of Jesus Christ, Lord. This morning, I pray you be with each one of them. And I just pray for families and relationships during these days. Father, I just pray you be with us now. May our worship this morning be in spirit and in truth. And I just pray that you would empty our minds of all the clutter this world likes to plug it with. And just be with us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to start our new study, if you will. We have been in the Old Testament book of Numbers the last 4 weeks. And as I said, we're trying to spend 3, 4, maybe 5 weeks in each book as we go, if you will, in order of the books, Old Testament, New Testament, Old Testament, New Testament, in alternating fashion. So today, we are now in the book of John, the last of the four Gospels, the book of John. And we're actually going to start in the beginning, in John chapter 1. And I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 14 from John. I'm reading from the New International Version. The words will be up here on the screen, and you can follow along with that. It reads, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all people might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every person was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor of husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Let's pray. Almighty God, we come before you to look at your Word and hear from you. We pray, Almighty God, that your Holy Spirit will penetrate our hearts and our minds, that we might hear from you. Lord God Almighty, hide me behind the cross. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Although the text that we read, and quite frankly throughout the book of John, it does not directly state or attribute who wrote it, but it has been attributed to the Apostle John from long history past, the early church, and early church historians attributed it to John. John was consistently part of the inner circle that Jesus would have. Often he would call Peter, James, and John alongside to see significant events, like, for instance, the transfiguration, the healing of the official Jairus' daughter, the discussion about the coming destruction of the temple, which also included Andrew. Andrew was part of that discussion as well. And Peter, James, and John were with Jesus. He called them aside as he went into Gethsemane and was in great distress and said, "Pray for me and with me." And so he was the inner circle and can certainly give a firsthand account of what was going on in Jesus' life. John is believed to be the disciple whom Jesus loved. And quite frankly, it is in the book of John that that title is attributed to him. Now, I have to be honest with you. I've actually preached a message in the past about John and this statement. If this truly is, and I believe it is, written by the Apostle John, if John is the disciple whom Jesus loved, and he keeps talking about it, seems kind of like an egotistical thing, right? Didn't Jesus love all the disciples? So I kind of had my mindset on that was that Scripture allows us to see the flaws in people as well as the good. And so here in my idea, as I was reading this, I'm saying, you know, here's John being boastful. Oh, yes, I'm the inner circle. And by the way, John was one, along with James, that asked Jesus to, "Hey, can we be on your right and left?" So it was kind of there was maybe an ego thing in there. But I have to admit, I looked at it as a negative part of John's life. And I read something the other day that grabbed me, and I thought, wow, maybe I've really been thinking about it all wrong. It's not that he was trying to highlight that he was something special, but that he was recognizing that Jesus was something special, that Jesus loved him, warts and all. The disciple, you know what? I'm loved by God. You know, you're loved by God. you are the disciple whom Jesus loved. And I just never thought of that approach to it. And I think that's a neat approach. It's the idea that John just wanted to continue to remind himself that Jesus loves me. Because that's an important thing that we need to be able to hold on to in life. I'm thinking of little Jacob that we just talked about. Knowing that Jesus loves you can help you hit and overcome a lot of different obstacles. And John will constantly address himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. The final chapter of the gospel gives us some evidence that helps us identify as well, in my opinion, that John was the author. Prior to the ascension of Jesus Christ, we're in chapter 21 of the book of John, we have that time where some of the disciples are saying, well, what do we do next? You know, they've seen Jesus, and, you know, well, what do we do now? And Peter says, I know, I'm going fishing. He reverted back to the trade that he knew. And so he goes off, and they say, yeah, we'll join you. And so they go to fish, and if you know the rest of the story, you know, Jesus is on the shore. He sees them, tells them, hey, you know, cast your net over on a certain side, and they do it, and they get this incredible catch of fish, and that's when they realize, wait a second, it's Jesus again. And they go flying in, if you feel, boating into the coast, and it's that encounter that Jesus has with Peter where he says three different times, Simon, do you love me? Simon, do you really love me? And so he has that discussion with Peter, also known as Simon. He has this discussion with him about love, and it's kind of, many people look at it as a reinstatement of Peter given his denial during the trials. And it is during that time that after Peter acknowledges his love for Jesus, that Jesus said to him, follow me. And as he's going with Jesus, it says that Peter looks back and he sees the disciple whom Jesus loved. And he looks at Jesus and says, well, what about him? You know, kind of like not worried about what God's called him to do. What about him? What's his ministry? And Jesus says, don't worry about him. You follow me. So we get this glimpse of this disciple whom Jesus loved being in that encounter. And if you go through a little bit of a process of elimination, that you will find that by eliminating the other disciples that were there for various reasons, that, well, it had to be John. Because there's only a few there with it, and you can easily take other ones out of it because of what we know in other scriptures. So there's some indication, I would suggest, in there that John is truly the author, and quite frankly, that's what the early church thought. What's the purpose of John's gospel? Why did he write this, if you will, supplemental gospel to the other three? The purpose of John's gospel is to prove that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. More importantly, that Jesus was indeed God in the flesh. He wanted to make a real big point, and that's why we're looking at this first chapter, because it's a foundation for everything that's going to follow in the book of John. He was targeting both believers, often Gentile believers, and skeptics or unbelievers. That's who he wanted to reach. We get that from his statement in John chapter 20, verse 31. It says, these things are written, all the things that he wrote before, all these things have written that you may believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So he has built the foundation throughout the gospel, as we're going to look at it over the next few weeks. He is building the case and demonstrating different parts of Jesus through his signs, and then he goes into the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and then, of course, the trial, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. So, while Matthew and Mark and Luke emphasize the human side of Jesus, Matthew and Luke have the genealogies that talk about how his descendancy works, John focuses on the deity of Jesus. It's great to recognize that he is, if you will, born of the flesh, miraculous birth as it was, but it's more important, perhaps, to recognize that he is also God. Fully man, fully God. And John's gospel throughout provides what I would suggest is the most direct connection to this concept of the Trinity, something that's really hard to grasp, this idea of one God in three persons, this monotheistic approach, where a lot of people look at Christianity and say, oh no, you believe in three gods. No, we believe in one God in three persons. And there's has been debate over the history of the church about this one in essence and three in substance. It's an interesting debate, but John really hits on that part. And in the beginning, he starts with just the, if you will, the first two persons of the Trinity. He says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. John is using some very specific language here. He is actually recalling or repurposing the language of the Old Testament that the Jews would certainly know. Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God spoke creation into existence. And John identifies the Word as Jesus in verse 14, where it says, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. So there's no question about the connection. The Word connects with God in creation, connects with Jesus in incarnation. And so those two short verses that we read, John provides a summary of the two members of the Trinity and presents Jesus Christ as deity, as God. And that's something he's going to flesh out throughout the gospel, and we'll probably hit on it in future messages. Verse 3 tells us that through him, through Jesus, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. And in Genesis, we learn that the earth was formless and void, and darkness hovered over the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. So there we have the connection with the three. If someone heard in the beginning, it would call them to cause them to think through Genesis. Then they'd think about the creation story. The Word is Jesus Christ, God, the Word, and the Holy Spirit hovering over the earth. So there's a, if you will, that's a real brief indication of the Trinity for the sake of our discussions. Yet it's important to know that all three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, were part of creation. They all had a part in it. And John is going to later expand fairly extensively on the work of the Holy Spirit. But he uses the language that he uses in order to grab the reader's attention, to make them, what we don't get in so many cases is the words that are used had an incredible influence on the people that were hearing at the time. The Greek word for word is this word logos or logos. Dr. David Chapman, he's a professor of Old Testament and archaeology. He said that the Stoics, those people that had the Stoic philosophy, they saw logos as the rational soul that was part of the universe. It was something inherent in the universe itself. There was a first century Jewish historian and philosopher, Philo. He connected logos with the utterance of God in creation. He, in his mind, it was God speaking. That was the Word. That was the logos of God. And John uses this word logos. It's a word, by the way, that we get the word logic from, to make a persuasive argument for Jesus as a Messiah and Jesus as God. We're going to see that in later messages when we see the numerous times that Jesus connects himself with the, if you will, the name of God, I am. And you're going to see that. And so John is trying to build an argument. He starts from a foundation. The foundation of, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Okay, so there's two individuals, yet the Word was God, brings them together. With God, was God. By the way, Jehovah's Witnesses will change that translation, and I believe they say he was a God. In other words, they actually manipulate the Greek and basically do not translate the Greek properly to make it fit their theology. But no, we're supposed to make our theology fit what is being said. So as we spend time in the next 3 or 4 weeks, we're going to see this case for Christ being built. But the foundation begins with, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That is the starting point that we have to build everything on. That's the foundation. Verse 4 and 5 build on the connection with Genesis, because this is through Jesus, everything was made through him. Through him, all things were made, and without him, nothing was made that has been made. That lets us know that Jesus was not an afterthought. Jesus was not a created being like the angels. He was in the beginning with God. Jesus was eternal. It's clear. In John chapter 8, verse 58, John records Jesus saying, "I tell you the truth, before Abraham was, I am." Using that indication. Matter of fact, they picked up stones to stone him because they said, because you make yourself equivalent with God. Because he used that term, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. Pre-existent. Not a created being. He was there from the very beginning. In verse 4 of our text today, it says, "In him we have life," or "in him was life, and that life was the light of people. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it." John will later record Jesus saying, "I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. And later, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus, God in the flesh, has life and death in his hands. And John focuses on the spark of life. Jesus did not come to destroy, but what? To create. All things were created through him. Nothing that was created without him. He came to create, to build up, to fulfill the promise of God in Genesis chapter 15 to bless all nations, the redemption of his creation. Now let's think about this idea that we think about Jesus and how he is a light that shines into darkness, but the darkness did not understand it. In the time of Christ, in fact, as recently as the 1800s, before the light bulb was invented, 1879, there was a great distinction between light and dark. Significant differences. If you were to go to a third world today and walk on the unlit roads of night, it's a little bit hairy. I've been into some African countries where at nighttime, well, you better have good lights in your car, because the people of Africa are dark, and the night is dark, and unless the stars and the moon are full blast, so to speak, it's dangerous in there. When you think about light and darkness, when the sun comes up, there's movement, there's action. When the sun goes down, there's inaction. It's this, what happens when it's dark and you don't have electricity and things like that? You go to bed. And then when the sun comes up, be it 5 o'clock in the morning, you get up. There's this big contrast between action and movement, if you will, life and inaction and death. Life and light are connected, but they also have their opposites. There's life and there's death. There is light and there is darkness. If a bright light, and there's examples in the scripture, by the way, of this, if there was a bright light filling a room at nighttime in ancient Israel, guess what? You would be scared. It would be overwhelming. Consider the shepherds when it says the angel of the Lord came and the glory of the Lord shone around them. This idea of this brilliance, and then all the multitude of angels joined him and said, "The glory of the Lord shined about them." There was this brilliance, and it was scary because God's glory is brilliance. But God in the flesh is incomprehensible. It's too much to grasp. And John starts with a big bang as he works to reach his readers with details to support the foundation he made. Jesus with God. Jesus is God. Jesus is the Creator. Jesus is light and life. And he's trying to get people to recognize it. Now, something happens here which I thought was strange in this scripture passages that we read, that we've get into this idea that he was the light and life of men, of people, and all of a sudden he goes from the deity of Jesus and his creation and being light and such, and he gives us this brief introduction to John the Baptist. I remember when I was a new believer, when I was reading this, I thought that the writer was John the Baptist. You know, it took a while before I understood that, no, this is just John, the Apostle John, making this brief introduction. He says, there came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every person was coming into the world. Think about the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They provide significant more detail on the ministry of John the Baptist, with Luke giving the most information. He gets into his birth and the circumstances around his birth. Matthew and Luke expand on the birth narratives of Jesus and his connection with humankind. They have the genealogies, that one connects him with Abraham, one connects it all the way to Adam. Mark links the appearance of John the Baptist with the prophecy, Old Testament prophecy, of a forerunner to the Messiah. That's where they go. John focuses on God in the flesh. That's kind of important, because he wants them to not just think of Jesus as a human conqueror, who many people thought that's what the Messiah would be. The Messiah is going to be, and he's going to relieve us of the occupation of Rome, and we're going to be our nation again, and it's going to be hunky-dory. That could cause people to focus on the wrong thing. And John wants to make a point. He's not just a conqueror to provide liberty for a brief amount of time. He is here for the salvation of humankind. In a sense, that brief introduction of John the Baptist, who he emphasizes was a man sent from God. In other words, he's saying he has authority. He was sent. He's an ambassador. He was sent from God. And it offered an opportunity to dig deeper into this incarnation and emphasize Jesus as light. John wasn't the light. John was there to testify about the light. And so in the first verse, we see Jesus identified by the word logos, word. In the introduction of John the Baptist, it expanded to say that he is light. So Jesus, the Son of Man, Jesus, God in the flesh, Jesus, light of the world. In fact, John later records Jesus making the exact same connection. It says in verse 12 of chapter 8, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have light of life. So Jesus is the word is one thing. Jesus is light, is life-altering. Because people knew what it meant to walk in darkness. That's what they had to do at night. There's a lot of examples in the scripture where it talks about make sure you have oil for your lamp. But I can guarantee you that if you've ever burned one of those little lamps from ancient times, it doesn't put off a great deal of light. And so you got to be really careful of where you're walking. You don't see too far ahead. When you walk in darkness, what happens? You get bruises. You trip over things. You forget that you moved a table in front of the area that you're going to walk through, and it hurts. You make wrong turns when you walk in darkness. Years ago, I was in a rental car in the United Kingdom. I had made a series of presentations north of London, and I had to drive to, and I'm going to butcher the name, I had to drive to Aberystwyth, which is in the Welsh part of the United Kingdom, on the, if you will, on the, that'll be the West Coast, on the West Coast. And so I, this was before there was Garmins and all that. At least if they had Garmins, I didn't have one. And I'm terrible directionally. If someone says, you know, hey, go here and go east, I'd say, is that a right or a left? I was always scared when I was a part-time deputy sheriff. I was always concerned if I was ever in pursuit, how I was going to give directions to people to help me. Go on the street and take a right, and the people say, east or west, Kelly, east or west. They're like, uh-oh, what am I going to do? Later, I thought, gee, I had to put a compass in my car so at least I can know which direction I'm going. But I'm terrible at that, but I can follow directions. And so the people, oh, no problem. You're going to go down. They gave me this direction, and you're going to here, and you're going to go there. And I'm driving the narrow roads of England, and it becomes night, and it's dark. And by the way, the other thing they told me, I said, well, I can always stop and ask people for directions when I get over that way. And he goes, well, over in that part of the country, they really don't like to speak English. It's kind of frowned on, so they might want to speak Welsh, so you may have trouble there. Okay, great. So I'm driving along in the dark, and the streets don't have any street signs. I'm in the rural streets, by the way, the rural roads. They have no sign. And so I'm going, okay, I guess I'll turn right here, or left here. Oh, I guess I'll turn right here. And I'm out in the country somewhere, having no idea where I was. And I even got to some place where all of a sudden I see some farmhouses, and I was tempted to knock on a door, but now it's getting dark, and I'm not getting dark, it's getting late. And so I just kept aimlessly driving around. It was a miracle that I actually got to where I was going, because I just say, well, I guess left. Oh, I guess another left, I guess. And finally, I found a place. But that's what it's like to be in darkness. And when the light comes on, it's kind of like, when I saw the light of the city, oh, yeah, it may not be the right city, but I can see that there's something there. There's a great difference when there is light. And John wanted to make this very clear distinction between Jesus and John the Baptist. People certainly were aware of the ministry of John the Baptist. He had made a big impact. Impact that even went to the king, to Herod. Big impact. Mark had written about John the Baptist's ministry. He said the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Many even thought that he might be the Messiah. The Pharisees and the scribes questioned him, are you the Messiah? And John made it very clear that, no, I am not. And the Apostle John, he wants to draw on that conclusion that, no, John Baptist is not it. John the Baptist is merely a forerunner. And then the Apostle John, after laying out the deity of Christ and the purpose of Christ in being the light that brings life to all men and women, he reflected on the response of those people that encountered him. Jesus who came in, God who came in the flesh, came into the world. John says he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, goes back to those first verses, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. As I think about those verses, you see there is, if you will, a global and a local response. The global one is that God, Jesus, came in as God in the flesh to the world that he created. Ta-da! Here I am. The Creator arrived, but the creation didn't recognize him. The creation kind of yawned. No big deal. The world didn't recognize the one who put it all together. And by the way, that's you and me. God in the flesh came and we turned our eyes. We turned our attention somewhere else. Yet Jesus also came to a people that he set apart when it all started. We read about it in Genesis chapter 12, how God set apart Abram, later to be called Abraham, and he built this succession of lines and told them that they're going to be in bondage, and he told them about redemption. He basically said, hey, this is what's coming. And so there was a people that were called by God to be a people that would be set apart that the world might see that there's something different. A world that believed in multiple gods, all of a sudden here is a people that believe in one God. A world that believed in gods that were spiteful and egotistical and fighting amongst themselves, to a single God filled with love and long-suffering and patience and desiring redemption. A big contrast to what the world had had. And yet it says that Jesus came to his own, but his own didn't receive him. You and I didn't receive him. Again, just to transfer that to us today. The world didn't receive him. That world didn't get it. And his very own people, whom the prophets had foretold was coming, they didn't accept him either. The good news that all was not and all is not lost. Throughout the scriptures, God is always providing a lifesaver. I used to say, and I guess it was somewhat irreverent, so I probably shouldn't say it, but I used to say, every once in a while, God shows his butt. And why I would say that is because you would go to, for instance, Genesis chapter 6, and that talks about when God saw that the thoughts and the motives and the inclination of the hearts of humankind was evil continually, it said that God said, you know what, I'm going to start it all over. I'm going to create this flood, and I'm going to rebuild. I'm going to recreate. We're going to try to get this thing back on task. But Noah found favor in the eyes of God. There's the lifesaver. Hey, I'm going to start it over, but I have to have the starting seed. But Noah. When God was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, when he brought out Lot and the member of his family who would believe what he said was going to happen. Flee, for I'll destroy this place. And some wouldn't go because they didn't believe, and his wife turned back because she really thought, gee, maybe that was a better place to be. But God has a lifesaver. He brings out those who would believe. I think it was last week, we talked about the bad report that the spies gave when they spied out the promised land, and they said, boy, it's a great land. It's really a land of milk and honey, but everybody's big. We can't do it. And then they talking around, telling people why they shouldn't go. And God said, as a result of you failing to believe my promise that I'm giving you this land, you're going to wander for 40 years because I'm going to raise up another generation. There's that lifesaver, another generation. But Caleb and Joshua and Moses, they believed God, and they lived through that 40 years of wandering. God's faithfulness, his long-suffering, the King James talks about, which is basically talking about his patience, his love is always seeking a way to draw us to him. And we get that lifesaver in John's text in chapter 12 and 13. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor of husband's will, but born of God. He came to his own, but they owned and received him. But yet to those who did receive him, to those who did believe in his name, he gave the power to become children of God. It's basically saying, guess what? It is not about your lineage. It is not about, are you of the line of Abraham? He came to the world. He came for everyone. That's the statement of John 3:16. For God so loved what? The world, that he gave his only begotten son. But he recognizes that not everyone will recognize, not everyone will receive him. So there's this twofold process that's going on. First, we receive him. What does that mean? To receive him means that we take hold of. Literally, it means to take grasp of or to take hold of who he is. That he is God in the flesh. That's the first step. But it's not enough. I would say, given the population of the world, that there are billions of people that believe in God. Billions of people that look and say, there must be a higher power. There must be something that started all of this. James said that you believe in there is one God, good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. So belief, taking hold of that understanding that there is a God, in this case that Jesus is God in the flesh, is the start. But what happens next? Those who believe in his name is added. To those who receive him, to take hold of him, and to those who believe in his name, what does that mean? It's the step of faith that is required to close the deal. Do you believe in Emmanuel, God with us? Do you believe in the name Jesus, Yeshua? God is salvation, or God saves. Do you believe that? It's not just saying, oh yeah, I believe this guy was named Jesus. No, it's, do you believe in the name salvation of God? Do you believe in the name God with us? It goes back to, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And it's when you receive and that you believe, that's when adoption takes place. That's when you become part of the family of God. And that's quite frankly what the church represents. The church here and the church wherever else preaches the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Jesus is God in the flesh, that Jesus came to redeem man, humankind. It's when you take hold of that, you believe it, you have faith, that's when the adoption takes place. And it, by the way, it's irrevocable. You know, your kids sometimes do things that make you angry. And your kids might do something that makes you say, I want to get you out of the door. But they never stop being your kid. And you never really stop loving them. And we will make mistakes. And God will do things in our life to draw us back. Adoption is permanent. If you receive and if you believe. So in this text that we learn that Jesus is truly man, Jesus is truly God, and Jesus is the one who gives life. So the question is, do we have the light within us? And are we allowing that light to brighten the rooms that we enter? Are we ready to give an answer for those who ask us the hope that is within us? And as Peter says, but do it with respect and with grace. It is a strong call for us to recognize that Jesus is God in the flesh. It's a hard thing to grasp. And as we go through parts of the book of John to get an idea of the message of John, and we see the signs that Jesus did that truly point to his deity, and to the Holy Spirit for its work in causing us to be convicted and turn to Christ, we will see that there is a light. And the scripture says, and that light was the light of all people. We need to get hold of the light. And I hope that that's what we do as we continue to look at the book of John. But let's pray. Almighty God, your word is true. Your word is full of light. And we thank you for the foundation built through the inspired word of the Apostle John, that we might recognize Jesus was with God. Jesus was God. And Jesus is God. Almighty God, fill us with your Spirit, that we might draw closer to you, that we might recognize you in our lives, and that we might see the glimpses of light you put all around us, that we might join together in the family of God, praising your name, no matter where we are. And these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand as we sing our closing song?
Desperately we need Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending the one that gives life, Father. We thank you that that Jesus is fully God. We may not understand exactly how it works, but we know that you have said that you are God, Jesus is God, and the Holy Spirit is God, Lord. And we just pray that, well, we thank you for Jesus that has given us physical life, Lord, and spiritual life to those of us who know him, Lord. And we just pray, as like the last song we just sang, that we would allow Jesus to reign in our lives as we go forward. In Jesus' name, amen.